Hey everyone, welcome to A. Radesky Genealogy. In today's episode, you're going to hear from Anthony Johnson. He's going to be talking about a gentleman who's buried in Old Union Cemetery. His name is Levi Scott, so stick around. Welcome to A. Radesky Genealogy. My name is Angela Radesky, and we are back at Old Union Methodist Church here in Townsend, Delaware. And I'm with Anthony Johnson. And Anthony has done a lot of research on the churches in the area and some individuals in the churches. And he is going to talk to us about a gentleman named Levi Scott. And so I'm going to let Anthony share some of the historical information that he found out about Mr. Scott.
Okay, well, Bishop Levi Scott is buried right behind us.
Okay.
This is his final resting place. But Bishop Levi Scott was a Delaware farm boy who was born right here in Odessa. And unfortunately, his father passed away really early. So his mother was left with the farm and young children. And young Levi did not get much of a formal education. It wasn't like in those days you had to pay to go to school, and his mother had the obligations of the farm, so he was hired out to work with one of her relatives in Odessa, who was a noted carpenter, so he became trained in doing cabinet making, carpentry, and a wheelwright. And one of his favorite pastimes was playing the violin. He loved his music. But his mother was a God-fearing woman, and she used to hitch up the horse and the wagon and bring him and his brother to church frequently. And not only that, but every evening they would have to say prayers, and mom would sing hymns and make them say their prayers. So quite a religious upbringing. And around his late teen years, during the early 19th century, revivalism was quite a thing. So he started feeling, it was natural for young folks at that time to feel like they needed to become religious, and so he started feeling that way, and he made his way into the home of an African-American family who were a free black family, perhaps they were farmers in the area, and this home was noted for people who wanted to get religion. So you couldn't just pretend that you wanted to get religion and walk in, but he found his way in the home, and that's where he got converted and became a Christian. So at a very early age, he went on to be a preacher, and he just decided to put his fiddle up and do the Lord's work.
Uh-huh.
And so at the age of 21-ish, he began preaching and got engaged and really stepped into his call to ministry. And quite a career in the ministry he had for somebody who was unlearned, per se.
Right.
So he sort of became self-learned or self-taught.
So his only education was what he learned when he was out on the land. I mean, he learned from life.
He learned from life, but he also felt that he needed to study.
Okay.
So he learned reading, writing, and ministers at that time had certain sermons that they had to read, as well as certain books that they had to read, and there were tests that they had to pass.
Okay.
And so he applied himself, and he educated himself to the point where he actually became a teacher for a local family.
Oh, good.
Yes. So one of the local farm families hired him to be the tutor for their children. Yes. So simultaneous to that, he continued to work the farm, but he eventually became an itinerant minister. in the Methodist Episcopal Church.
And what is an itinerant minister? For those of us who don't know, I don't.
So that's a traveling minister. That's a minister who travels from town to town on a circuit of churches.
Okay.
And that's basically what he did. But he in his career, he went up the ranks rather quickly. He became a preacher, and then he became what was called a presiding elder or superintendent of other preachers.
Okay, so he was basically over. So yes. It's kind of like if you were to look in the current world, if you're looking in the corporate world, you have, you're
supervisor.
Working as a supervisor.
He was a supervisor. He was a supervisor of other ministers. And he took a brief time off from that work, and he went to become the head of the Methodist Book Concern in New York City.
Okay.
So that was the publishing house that published all of the hymn books and prayer books of the Methodist Episcopal Church.
Oh, wow.
And he went on to do that work in New York for several years. And along the way, he also became principal of a high school in Pennsylvania. It was the high school for Dickinson College. And he did that several years as well. So for a person who didn't have a formal education, he actually received an honorary doctorate of divinity. So he was quite an accomplished person.
Oh my gosh.
Quite an accomplished person.
And coming from the background that he did, it was obviously not a privileged background
privileged
by any
at
means
all.
At all.
That is correct.
And he was one that he had the drive because he knew his thought was through religion, which is where he was wanting to go.
That is correct.
That's where he was able to make the changes in people's lives and advancements and change the community and the way people perceive things, I'm assuming, here within this area and surrounding areas. I mean, he ended up in New York.
He ended up in New York. He ended up in Carlisle, Pennsylvania. And then in 1852, he was elected bishop of the Methodist Episcopal Church. And he's the first person from Delaware to have been elected a bishop of the Methodist Episcopal Church. And he was bishop of the Methodist Episcopal Church at a crucial time in history during the Civil War years. And from the time that he became a preacher in the early 1820s until the 1850s, Methodism had grown to become the largest denomination in the country. So of all of the religious denominations, Methodism was the fastest growing and had become the largest. As the country had an issue with slavery, so did Methodism. And Bishop Scott's record indicates that he was one of the bishops who were from a slave state. And what's significant about that is you had northern bishops from New England who were considered abolitionists, and southerners who were pro-slavery. And Bishop Scott was probably not an abolitionist, but he was definitely not pro-slavery. He was anti-slavery in New England. But the church was splitting or tearing in two between the Methodist Church North and the Methodist Church South. And one of the signature parts of his record is that he was able to hold the church together. The Methodist Church North, he was able to hold together. So that's really who he was. And he had the respect of people throughout the country. So he was quite a dynamic person.
He definitely was. There is a huge history on him. And what is this book that you're holding here?
So this is an issue of Methodist History. It's a volume that's put out by the United Methodist Church.
Uh-huh.
And one of his church historians, Reverend Joe DiPaolo, has written a little bit, a scholarly article on Bishop Scott's interaction with the African-American community. Bishop Scott initiation into the faith was in the home of a colored family.
Right. And I was going to ask you, how often, because you've done a lot of research on the churches around here and the families and how, and the churches and how they work with the free blacks walking them into their congregation. How common was that?
Uncommon. Completely uncommon.
Okay.
So, of all the bishops at that time and out of many of the ministers of that time, your conversion was something that throughout your ministry you always referred back to, and your conversion or your initiation into the faith was a dramatic piece of your ministry. So your conversion into the faith was a big deal, and he stood out because his took place in the home of a colored family under a prayer meeting that was led by Christian women. At least that's the way the New York Times wrote about it.
Oh my gosh. Okay, that part, yeah. Okay. So do we know who the family was, the home that we went into? Do we know who the family was?
So the Carter family, Isaac and Betsy Carter, were the names of a free black family that lived in Appomattox County, Southern New Castle County, Delaware. They were landowners and members of the Methodist Church.
Okay, so were they eventually members of this? I would say
he was never the pastor of a church where they were members. Their membership was at Lee Chapel, which is about 2 miles north of here. But it's pretty safe to say that he probably would have been someone who was called into the pulpit at their church.
And his life is very
here.
Okay.
So this is where I'm a little fuzzy.
Okay.
All right, but I want to say they had 6 or 7 children.
Oh, wow.
And only 3 were surviving.
Okay.
Yes, so, but he himself was not a, large and strapping and strong man.
Well, it doesn't look like in the picture. He looks like he's a very slender, tall man.
He was a slender person, and he was frail and sort of sickly the entire time of his ministry. But his wife, too, lived here in Odessa and raised a family here. So 3 of their children did survive, and one of their daughters married into the Townsend family, which is a prominent family
in the area.
We even have a municipality with that name,
yes.
Townsend.
Townsend.
Yes. And at today's gathering, there were some of his descendants.
Oh, that's right. You were pointing out there was a
So his second great-grandson was present today at today's service.
Well, maybe if we can locate him before we leave.
We can give it a try.
And give it a try and see if we can introduce him and see if he has any stories. Thank you so much.
You're most welcome.
For sharing everything with me. Thank you, Anthony, so much for sharing everything with us today. Hey, everyone. I hope you enjoyed today's episode, my interview with Anthony Johnson out at Old Union Cemetery. Make sure to give me some thumbs up, leave me some comments down below, and if you haven't subscribed, please do so that way I know what I'm doing is something you like to watch. I'll talk to you later.